Hello everyone, welcome to Geeks for Geeks. In this amazing video, we are going to learn how you can create a simple stock trend prediction web application using Streamlit. So before we move further to the coding part, first let me show you the simple introduction of the final output that we are going to get. So first of all, we have a simple text input field where the user has to enter the stock ticker. Stock ticker is nothing but the symbol that is assigned to that stock in the market. So for Tesla, we have TSLA, right? So next thing, we are having the data description, which is printed using df.describe function. I hope you are familiar with this pandas simple function, df.describe, right? Now I have chosen the data from 2010 to 2019, and I have divided this complete data set into two parts, that is training and testing. Training set I have decided to be 70% and testing part I have decided to be 30%. So my final prediction is going to be on testing part only, and we are going to plot a simple graph which will be showing me the predicted values and the actual values. So in this table, I'm going to see the description of the data, that is high. In the high column, we are having high, low, open and close for a particular day. So in this high, I can see that the maximum high in those around 10 years we are having is $87. In the low, we are having the minimum low is $2.9. The maximum opening value is 87. And the minimum opening value is $3.22. So like this, you can have a simple description of your data between 2010 to 2019. You can choose your own time frame. It's totally up to you. And you can decide it when you are coding the complete project, right? So let me show you the simple visualization of the closing price. Now in this video, we will be working on this closing column, because we are interested in finding the, or we can say predicting the closing price for a particular day. So this is a closing price versus time chart, and I can see that this is a simple chart for the closing price. Now let me also give you a simple introduction about moving averages. So this red line, which you can see, is the moving average, that is 100 days moving average. A 100 days moving average is nothing but it is plotted in this manner, like it will take the average of the previous 100 days closing price, and it will get a value and it will plot that on the graph. So as you can see over here, because it will start after getting the 100 values. That's why it is not starting from the starting point. So I hope you got this 100 days moving average. Now technical analysts in the market follow this strategy that if 100 days moving average crosses above the 200 days moving average, then there is an uptrend. And if 100 days moving average crosses below the 200 moving average, then it's a starting point of the downtrend. That's why we can see over here also, if I show you, this red line is my 100 days moving average and this green line is my 200 days moving average. Now at this point, this red line has crossed above the green line. That's why it's a starting of a uptrend. And if I show you over here, the red line is going below the green line. That's why it's starting of a downtrend. So this is a very simple strategy that technical analysts follow in the market to predict, or we can say to analyze a stock. And we can see above, we can see over here also in the ending part, this red line is going above the green line. That's why it is a starting of a uptrend, right? So now this is the predictions versus actual chart. Now if I show you the legend, the red line is my original price and this green line is the predicted price. So we can see that we are getting a very good general idea about how my stock is performing in these days, right? So there is a simple offset. Offset is nothing but the difference between the original and the predicted price, or the gap. And we are having a very less offset, so it's totally fine. And in this video, we will be working on this. So let me just change the stock ticker, and then we will be moving on to the coding part. So let's take an Indian stock. So I will take the stock of the State Bank of India. You can just go on this Yahoo Finance website, and we are also going to use this website for scraping the data, stock data, for our analysis, right? So you can search for any stock. So let me search for State Bank of India, and you can get the stock ticker from here, sbin.ns. Copy it, and we can just paste it over here and click enter. So now the data that we'll be showing will be regarding the State Bank of India. So this is the State Bank of India data description from 2010 to 2019, right? And this is a closing price versus time chart. And this is with the chart, this is the same chart with the 100 days moving average applied on it. And this is again the same chart with 200 moving average and 100 days moving average applied on it. And here, from here also, I can see that If the red line is going below the green line, then it's a starting of a downtrend. That's a very simple strategy, and I must tell you that this video is completely for education purpose. You should not try with original money based on these predictive analysis, right? Okay, so now this is the final predictions versus actual chart, and you can see that offset is very, very low and we are getting a very good results. So now I hope you are familiar with what we are going to get after this tutorial. And so let's move on to the Jupyter Notebook. First of all, I will be working on Jupyter Notebook, and I will be then working on my Streamlit web application, right? So in my desktop, I have created a project that is Python project, and inside it I have folder GFG, and inside it I have again a folder called Geeks for Geeks. Now in this folder, I'm going to create a Python 3 file. So let's create it, and now I'll be start coding. So first of all, let's rename this file as we are going to use the stacked LSTM deep learning model. So you should be having some knowledge about it, and you should also be familiar with what is deep learning and all, right? So let's name it LSTM model. Let's rename it, and first of all, let me just import some basic libraries. So let's import NumPy as np. Let me increase the font size so that it is visible to you. Yes. So first of all, I'm importing the NumPy. Then I will be importing pandas as pd. Then matplotlib, import matplotlib.pyplot as plt. Then let's import pandas data reader. Now I'm importing this library because I want to scrap the data from this Yahoo Finance website. So import pandas data reader as data. So let's run this cell. Perfect. Now I'm going to define the starting and the ending point. So you can define it according to you. And it's a suggestion from my side that you should take a bigger data frame, a bigger time frame for your data set, because that will really improve the accuracy of your model. So for now, let's define the data starting from 2010, first January. So January, then the date, that is first. So, and let's define the ending point. So for the ending point, I'm going to define 2019. Let's take December and 31st of December. Right, now I'm going to create df, that is my data frame, data dot data reader. You have to define, let's define the stock of Tesla, so TSLA for now. But when I will be building the Streamlit web application, I will make it dynamic, so user can enter any stock ticker and he can predict the values. But for now, for working on this, for creating the model, we can say I'm going to work with Tesla stock. And now let's Tesla stock we have already analyzed, so let's take Apple stock. That will be really good. So let's take Apple, and I have to define Yahoo. Then we have to define start point and the end point. Perfect. Now I can see the data, so df.head. Let's run it. Here you can see that my data is starting from 31st December 2009. And if I run df.tail, you will be able to see that my data is ending at 2019, 31st of December, right? Perfect. Now we can move further, and I just want to reset my index. I don't want these dates because they are not useful for me. That's why I'm going to write df.resetindex, df.resetindex. And I will again store this df in df. And now if I see df.head, you can see that these dates are not the index now. It's just a simple column which I can just drop. So I will just run a simple statement. Df is equal to df.drop. And I'm interested in dropping this date column. Then I also don't want this adjusted close column. And I will run axis is equal to 1. If I now run df.head, I can see that I am having only these 5 columns. Now our web application is based upon this close column, but you can also create a web application for open, low, high and volume predictions, right? It's totally up to you. But now we will be working on this close column. So what I will do is, first of all, let's plot it. So plt dot plot df dot close. If I just run it, I can see a simple graph showing the closing price of Tesla stock, right? Now, how can we just create the moving averages, right? So if I just show you this df, you can see that this is the close column, right? Now the moving average is going to be, let's say I'm working on 100 days moving average, right? So for the 100 values, it will not be able to create any moving average, but for the 101 value, that is 101 index, it will just find the mean of the previous 100 closing values and it will just plot that on my graph, right? So for that, you have to use the rolling function. So first, let me define MA 100, that is moving average 100, is equal to df dot close dot rolling 100, that is 100 days, and dot mean, right? And now if I just run MA 100, you can see that for the first 100 values, it will be null because it should have previous 100 values for getting the mean, and for it will be starting from 101 index and it will be able to find the moving average. Now I want to plot this moving average on my closing graph. So what I will do, I will define a plt.figure, plt.figure with a fig size of 12,6. Then I will first plot plt.plot df.close, and then I will be plotting plt.plot this MA100 with red color, right? So let's run it, and you can see that this is my simple graph with 100 days moving average. Now in the same way, I can just define my 200 days moving average, and stock analyst or we can say the technical analyst follow different strategies. They work with moving averages, they work with exponential moving averages and lot, but in this case we are interested in machine learning model, so we will not dive deeper into these topics, but you can obviously read them on the internet. They will really help you analyze the stocks in a different perspective, right? So now I will just keep it 200 and let me just run it. So the first 200 days it will be null, but starting from 201 index it will be the value will be there. So let's create the chart for it. So let me just paste it. Now I will also be plotting 200 days moving average. So plt.plot MA200, let's keep it green color, and when I run it, I can see that I get the 100 days moving average and 200 days moving average, right? I hope it is clear to you till now. We have not done something extraordinary till now. We have just plotted the simple visualizations, right? So now let me just show you the df.shape so you have an idea how many rows and how many columns we have till now. So we are having 2517 rows and 5 columns, but our main data is a closing column, right? So we will be working on one column only. So now we have to split our data into training and testing, right? So I'll just put a simple comment, splitting data into training and testing. So I will define two variables called data training will be pd.dataframe. So I want to create a data frame for this training and testing also. And in this pd.dataframe, I will be having df at close because I will be interested in close column. And starting from the zero index, I want to go till 70% of the total values, right? So what I will do, int of length of df into 0.70, right? And for data testing, I hope you are getting. So data testing will be pd.dataframe df at close, and it will be starting from this 70% value. So I will just copy it, I'll paste it over here, and it will be going till the complete length. So int of length of df, and I can just show you the shapes of these two variables. So print data training dot shape and print data testing dot shape, and I will run it, and you can see that it is giving me 1761 and 756, right? And if you will add them, you will get this 2517. Perfect. So now we have splitted the data, and it is in such a manner that 70% data is my training data and 30% data is my testing data. Correct. Now if you want to see the training data, let's have a look. So data training dot head. Yes, you can see that this is the data starting from zero index. And if I show you data testing dot head, it will be the next 30% data, right? So it is starting from 1761 to 1765. It is just the head part, right? It is not ending at 1765. It will be ending at 2517. Yes, 2517. Correct. So we have splitted the data into training and testing successfully. Now we should just move on to scaling down the data, right? So for the stacked LSTM model, we have to scale down the data. We can't provide this data. So we will be scaling down the data between 0 and 1. So for that, we have to import min-max scaler from sklearn.preprocessing. So from sklearn.preprocessing, import min-max scaler. Now I will define an object of this min-max scaler, and you can define the feature range between 0 comma 1, right? And now I can just fit my data into this min-max scaler. I will fit my training data first. So let's run it. And my new data training, I will also convert it into an array. So I will keep it array, and I will do scalar dot fit transform data training. You can see over here, right? And if I just show you data training array. So if you're not getting something, let me just do a quick recap. First of all, we are interested in df.close column. So we have chosen that column, and we have just divided that complete column into training and testing, right? So 70% data is my training, 30% data is my testing. And after this, I have just scaled down the training data, because first of all, we are working on this training data only, and we have just scaled it down using min-max scalar, and I have converted that into an array. So this is data training array. So scalar.fitprom will fit transform will automatically give me an array, and I have stored that array in data training array. Perfect. Now this is my array, right? Okay, so now we have to divide our data into training, x-train and y-train. So for that, I am going to define to list, empty list, x train and y train. And now you need to understand a simple logic that we are going to follow to predict our values. So let me just open Notepad and let me show you what we are going to do now. So let's say for 10 days data I am taking, and I have to predict the stock price for 11th day, right? So let's say the stock starts from $34 on the first day. Next day it increases to $36, and next day it decreases to $33, and next day it becomes $40, let's say, and then it decreases to $39, then it becomes $38, then $37, then again it becomes $42. So we have taken 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 days data. Next day it becomes $44, and then it becomes let's say $38. So we have taken the 10 days data, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And now I want to print, or we have to predict the value of 11th day. So you should know that the value of the 11th day is going to be dependent on these 10 values, right? Previous 10 days data, it will not just become $100 or $200 on 11th day. It will be just dependent on these dollars only. It will be around in this range only, right? So we can say that the data on a particular day or we can say the price on a particular day for a stock is dependent on the previous few days, right? So this is a simple logic that we are going to follow, and we can say that this is my X train, and the value for the 11th day, let's say it becomes $43, is my Y train. And this steps is not fixed to be 10. We can just change the steps. This is called a steps, right? I took 10 days steps, and you can take 100 days steps or a 60 days step. And for this tutorial, we are going to take 100 days step. That means for the first 100 days, right? For the first 100 days, it will become my X train. It will become my features. And this will become my predictive class, that the class that is to be predicted, Y train, right? Let me repeat. For the first 100 days, those 100 days are going to become my X train, and the 101th day, that is 101th day, is going to be my Y train, right? Perfect. And now let's say we have to predict the 12th day data, right? So this data, this $34 will be gone, right? And this 43 will become my part of the X train. And then I have to predict the Y train. Let's say it becomes $42, right? So now this is my X train and this is my Y train. So like this, it is going to go till the end of our data frame, the time frame that we have provided. And after each step, it is going to forget one data from the starting, and it will consider the next data as the X train only, right? So let's take one more example. Let's say we have to predict the 13th day data. So it will be part of this, and this 36 will be gone from here. And now this complete array is X train, and now we have to predict the value of the 13th day. Let's say it becomes 38. So now this is my Y train. Perfect. So I hope you are getting it. So that's why I have defined two lists, X train and Y train. Now we have to insert values in this list. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to define a for loop. So for I in range, and over here I'm going to define my steps as 100 days, right? So I'm going to starting from 100, and I have to take the data training array. So if I just show you the data training array dot shape, so let me just take it, data training array dot shape, it is 1761. That means 1761 rows of data is in my training part, and the rest of the rows is in my testing part. So to make it dynamic, I don't need to write 1761 over here. I can just write data training dot shape at 1, right? At zero, because this 1761 is at zero index only, right? So it will go till here, and now I have to append the data in my X train. So X train dot append data training array, and I have to append I minus 100. So it should start from 0, right? That's why it is I minus 100, because our I is starting from 100 only. So I minus 100, and it will go till I. And in my Y train dot append data training array, it will start from I comma 0. Only one column, right? That's why it is 0. It is not colon, it is a comma, right? Because we are considering only one column, right? Perfect. Now we have added the values, stock prices in X train and Y train. So let me just show you X train. Let's just print X train. And it is just dividing the data set. And this is my X train. Now we have to convert this X train and Y train into NumPy arrays, so that we can, we should be able to provide this data to our LSTM. So X train comma Y train is equal to np dot array X train comma np dot array Y train. Let's run it. So I can say that my X train and Y train are also ready, and now we should be moving on to making the machine learning model. So I'll put a comment and I will write ML model. And now let's import from keras.layers, import dense dropout, And we have to also consider LSTM. And again, we have to import from keras.models. We have to import sequential model. Now I'll be creating the model. So first of all, we have to create a sequential model. Model.sequential. Next thing is we have to start adding the layers. So first of all, we have to add a LSTM layer. So model.add LSTM. And we have to add the units will be 50 units. And we have to also define the activation function as ReLU. And we need to define return sequences to be true. Return sequences to be true. And then we have to define the input shape. So input shape will be, as you can see over here, I have run this cell extreme.shape. So in this extreme.shape, you can see that we have 1661 rows and 100 columns. So how these 100 columns? Because we had defined the step as 100. That means the first 100 values have become the columns because they have to act as the features for predicting my phi train. That's why we are interested in this value, that is 100 only. So for getting this 100 value, I want it to be, so in the brackets you have to write xtrain dot shape at 1 comma 1. So why at 1? Because this 100 is present at index 1 and this 1 is nothing but the number of columns. So we are working with df dot close, right? That is closing column. That's why it is 1. Because but if you would be working with 3 or 4 columns, that is you would be predicting open, high, low, close and volume, everything, then it would be 4 or 5 according to the number of columns. But now we are working with only closing column, that's why it is only 1. So now we have to add dropout layer. So model dot add dropout, and the dropout will be of 0.2. Now we can just copy this layer and we can just paste it. And we will change a few things. So for the second layer, we have to just change the units to be, let's say, 60. And we have to remove this input shape also. And the dropout, I will keep it to be 0.3. Rest everything will be same. Now for the third layer, we have to increase the units to 80 and I will remove this input shapes and 0.3 my dropout will be now. And for the last layer, that is the last layer, yes, my units will be 120 and I will remove this input shapes from here and we also need to remove this return sequences and my dropout will be now 0.4. And for the second last layer, we have done a simple mistake. We have to increase the dropout. And for the last layer, my dropout will be 0.5.
Yes.
Now this is my simple ML model. And the last layer, we have to add the dense layer to connect all these layers. So model.add, it is the dense layer. And for the dense layer, we are going to have only one unit because we have to predict only one value, that is closing price, right? And I can just run this. And we are not getting any error. Now we can just see the summary. So model.summary. And you can see the simple summary of my ML model, LSTM model. And now we can just compile our model. So model.compile. Optimizer will be Adam optimizer. Adam optimizer. And I also need to define the loss. Loss will be mean squared error, right? Mean squared error. And then I can fit my data, model dot fit xtrain comma ytrain. And you need to define the epochs and I'm going to define 50 epochs and now let's run it. And till it will be running, I will be just doing a quick recap of what we have done till now. So let's run it. So it is running. So let's wait and let's do a quick recap. So first of all, I'm importing all the libraries. Then I'm defining the start and the end. And it's totally up to you, but you should define a bigger data frame, right? Then I'm just scrapping the data from this Yahoo Finance website. And then what I'm doing, I'm just printing the head part and printing the tail part. And then I'm just removing this date as an index. So I'm just resetting my index. And I'm just dropping the columns which are not useful for my analysis, that is date and the adjusted close. Now we are left with these five columns. Now it's totally up to you which column you want to predict. I'm interested in this close column because I want to predict what will be the closing price for a particular date, right? So I'm just plotting this df.close and I can see that this stock is in uptrend and it is growing very nicely. And the next thing is working with the moving averages. Moving averages are nothing but they are the average of a particular time frame. So we have defined 100 days moving average. That means it will take the 100 days closing price and it will find an average, right? And see, that's same way we have defined our 200 days moving average and we have plotted the three plots in the same graph. So you can see over here that we have plotted the closing prices. Then we have plotted 100 MA and the 200 MA. Right. Then we have splitted the data into training and testing that we usually do for data predictions. So we have splitted the data into training and testing in such a manner that 70% of my complete data frame is in training and 30% of data is in my testing. Then we have to convert these data into scaled data. That's where I'm importing min-max scaler. And I've defined this feature range from 0 to 1. That means all the values of these closing prices will be scaled down between 0 and 1. That's the way we have to provide the data to my LSTM model. That's why we are scaling it down, right? Then I just saw the shape of the data, training data, and I saw that it contains 1761 rows. Then we have to split our data into training X-train and Y-train. So that's why we have to use a simple time series analysis analogy that value for a particular day, or we can say the closing price for on a particular day will be dependent on the previous days. And for the previous days values, we have defined the step as 100. That means the value for the 101 day will be dependent on the previous 100 days. That's why these previous 100 days values will become my X train and that 101 date value will become my Y train. That's the same thing we have done, and then we have converted our X-train and Y-train into NumPy arrays, and then we have defined a simple LSTM model. So these are the four layers in my LSTM model, and finally we have the dense layer, which is to connect all these layers. Then we have just seen the model.summary, and then we have compiled the model with Adam Optimizer, and we have kept the loss as mean squared error, right? So other types of losses are cross categorical cross entropy and binary cross entropy. That is usually for classification purpose, right? But here we are doing time series analysis, and for that the loss we are keeping it to be mean squared error, right? So let's see how many epochs have run. So we are currently on 21st epoch. So let's wait to let it complete, right? So now we have completed running all the epochs and our model is trained. So now let's save this model so that we can use this model for our Streamlit web application. So I will write model.save and we have to define the name. So let's keep it keras model.h5. Let's run it. Yes, so now this model would be saved over here as you can see in the project folder, right? So now we can just move on to predicting the values. So for that, we are going to use the testing data, right? So you now know, you remember, right? So you know that the 30% of the data is my testing data. So if I just see data testing dot head, you can see that this is my testing data. But you should remember that for predicting the value for this 1761 index, I need the previous 100 days. Right, that's the same concept of time series analysis, right? For predicting this index for 1761 index, I need the previous 100 days, and those 100 days values are present in my training data. And to get those values, I have to fetch those 100 days from the training data, the last 100 days, and I have to append that list or append that data frame with this data frame, right? So what I will do, past 100 days will be data training. I hope you are getting what I'm doing. So let me just do a quick recap what I'm doing. For predicting the values for testing data, right? My motive is to predict the values for testing data. For predicting the values for this data testing, I need the previous 100 days. But I know that for the 1761 index, I don't have the previous 100 days. You can see it over here also. For the 1761, I have the values of the 100 days in data training dot tail 100. Right, so these are the 100 values which I need to append to my data testing so that I should be able to predict the values for starting from 1761 to the 99 days, right? That's why. So let's do it. So data training dot tail 100, past 100 days, right? And I will just run it. And now my final DF, final data frame will be past 100 days dot append. I will append the data testing with ignore index is equal to true. That means this past 100 days data, in this past 100 days data, I have appended the data testing, right? So now first 100 days, last 100 days for this data training and the data testing are now appended. They are connected, right? Perfect. So now let's move further. Let's run it. And now we are ready with the final DF. You can now see final DF dot head. So this is the testing data, right? Now again I have to apply scaling down, right? I have to apply min max scaler because this data is not scaled down, right? This is the testing data. So what I will do, let's name it as input data. So input data will be scalar dot fit transform final df. And if I now see input data, you can see that all the rows are now scaled down between 0 to 1, right? Now if I just see the shape of this input data, input data dot shape, it consists of 856 rows and only one column, that is the closing price column, right? So now I have to again define xtest. Previously we defined xtrain and ytrain. So now we have to define xtest and ytest. And again I will do the same thing. I will define the steps as 100. So for I in range, it will start from 100. It will go till inputs dot shape, input data dot shape at 0. So I want it to go till 856. That's why input data dot shape at 0. So I will now append my xtest. Xtest dot append with input data at I minus 100 till I, and my ytest dot append input data starting from I till 0. Sorry, not till 0, it is the 0th column, that is closing price column, right? Perfect. So now I can just run it. And again, I need to convert them into NumPy arrays. So xtest is equal xtest comma ytest is equal to np dot array xtest comma np dot array ytest. So let's print their shapes, or we can say shapes. So xtest dot shape and print ytest dot shape. So for xtest our shape is 756 comma 100 comma 1, and for the ytest our shape is 756, right? So now we have to predict. So I will put a comment called making predictions, and my predictions variable will be called yPredicted is equal to model dot predict xtest. We have to make predictions for xtest, right? So I will run it and all the predictions will be made, and I can check the shape of this y predicted. y predicted dot shape, and it is 756,1, right? And y test shape is also same. So I can just print y test. So this is my y test, and I can also print y predicted. I can just run it. So it is very hard to just check which all values are, like, how are they matching, right? So what I will do, so over here you can see that all these values are scaled down, so I have to again scale them up. So I will just find this factor by which I scaled it down. So scalar dot scale underscore, so this will give me the factor by which all these values were scaled down. So it is 0.02099517. So I will just copy it. So I need to divide my y predicted and y test value by this factor. So let's call it as a scale factor as 1 by this value. And now I can just multiply my y predicted is equal to y predicted into scale factor, and y test is equal to y test into scale factor. So instead of dividing, I just multiplied it by 1 by scale factor, 1 by scalar, right? So let's run it. And now I can just plot the predicted and the original values. So plt.figure, fig size will be 12,6. And now I can first of all plot the original values. So plt.plot y test with red color, and let's keep it blue color, and then I can just define the label as original price, and then I can define or plot the y predicted with the red color, and I can give it a label of predicted price. And I can give plt.x label as time, and plt.y label as price. And then I can also define plt.legend, and I can just now plt.show. Just run it. And you can see that how perfectly the predicted values and the testing values are matching, right? So perfect. So this is how we have found the predicted values or predicted, or we can just say a stock trend, right? It is not, we cannot say it is the perfect predicted values, but it is giving me a very perfect trend for the Tesla stock, sorry, for the Apple stock, right? We are working with the Apple stock. So it is giving me a very good trend. So now what I need to do is I need to create the Streamlit web application. That is over here. We have the Keras model.h5 and we have the LSTM model. I will just create a new file called app.py, and I will just run it. And now I just need to copy all this stuff, the main stuff, into my app.py. So I will just do it in front of you only. So first of all, we need to import all these values. So paste it, and I will define the start and end. Then I will also web scrap the data. So next thing is, and one more file we need to import, that is import from keras.models import load model, because we need to load the model that we had created. We are not going to run epochs every time, so we need to load that same model. So we have defined start and then we have scrapped this data, and now I will just define st. So we need to import Streamlit. So import Streamlit as st, and I will define st.title as stock trend prediction, right? And I will take an input from the user, the stock ticker. So I will call it user input is equal to st.text input, enter stock ticker, and by default I want to keep it of Apple, so AAPL, and this start and end it's totally up to you, but I want to keep it just statics. You can change it to 2021 also, and you can predict the next 100 days values or next 10 days stock price, right? It's totally up to you. So I have defined the user input. Now for the data reader, I will not fetch the data of Apple. In fact, I will fetch the data of this user input. So I'll keep it over here, and it's correct now. So I will not print this df.head. And the next thing that we need to do is making the we have made the data frame, right? And now I need to just describe the data in front of the user. So I will just write describing data, and then I will write st dot subheader, and I will write the title as data from 2010 to 2019, and after this I will just write st dot write df dot describe df dot describe. And if I run the app till now, let's see what we get. So let's run it. So we have to, this project, we have to open command prompt, and we need to write streamlit run app.py. So you can see over here what I have written, streamlit run app.py, and you have to hit enter. So you will be able to see the streamlit web application which we have built till now. So you can see over here we have the stock trend prediction, we have the stock ticker. I can just write, let's say I write SBI.NS, SBI.NS, that is State Bank of India, and if I just hit enter, you will be able to see. Okay, we have now, we don't need the dates, and SBIN.NS it is. So let me just write SBIN.NS, and yes, now we are able to see the data for State Bank of India, right? And let's build the app further. So we have built the, we have built till description, right? Now the next thing that I want to do is the visualizations. So visualizations, in the visualization, first of all I just want to plot the simple closing price chart. So for that I will just write st dot subheader, and inside it I will write closing price versus time chart, and inside it I will just write a figure is equal to plt dot figure with fig size as, let's keep it 12,6, and plt dot plot df dot close, right? And then I will write st dot pyplot, and it will be this fig. So let me just increase the font size. Yes, so now let's save it, and if I just rerun it over here, you will be able to see the chart of the closing price for State Bank of India. Now I want to plot moving average on it, so I'll just copy the same thing, I'll paste it over here, and I will also write with 100 moving average. So for that I will define my MA 100 as df dot close dot rolling with 100 values dot mean, and I will also plot plt dot plot this MA 100, and I will also plot the 200 days moving average. So let's paste it, and I can just copy the same thing. In the mean you have to define this parenthesis over here also. I just copy the same thing, so copy it, then paste it, make it 200, and over here also make it 200, and you can just plt dot plot make it 200, and you can also write and 200 moving average. So let's save it, and I can just rerun it. So you will also be able to see the 100 days moving average and 200 days moving average. Just the colors are changed. Colors are totally up to you, right? Colors, it's totally up to you. You can just define, write blue over here, and you can define green over here, you can define red over here. It's totally up to you. I'm not going to change it. You can change it according to you. Now we have completed the visualizations. Now we need to just split the data into training and testing. I'm again doing it because I want to just get the last few days data. I don't want the complete data to be printed on my web app. So I'm just doing the same thing. So I will just copy that stuff from my LSTM model. It is this, yeah. So I will just divide it into training and testing again. Yes, so just copy it. And you can just paste it over here. And the next thing that we will be doing is min-max scaling. Again, we have to scale the data because we need to feed this data into our LSTM model, that keras-model.h5 file. So that's why I'm just scaling it down again. Then you can just fit transform it. So I'll just copy this line and paste it over here. Then I will just split my data into X-train and Y-train. So I'll again copy the same stuff, paste it over here. So let me just put a comment what we are doing. So we are just dividing, or we can just say splitting data into X-train and Y-train. Right. So yes. So next thing that we need to do is we need to import. We don't need to import these keras and layers because, and again, we don't need to make this model because we already have the model. So I'll just load that model. So what I will do is after it, I will load my model. So my model will be load model keras model.h5. And you have to make sure that you have this keras model.h5 in the same folder in which you are working, right? So I have loaded my model. Now I am going to make the predictions. And yes, so for making the predictions, I have to feed the data into this model. So for that, I will again take the past 100 days data. So I'll directly come to this part where I was just taking the past 100 days data from the training. So let's copy it and let's paste it. I'll put a comment testing part. Right. So again, I will just copy this same stuff, final DF, paste it. And yes, so you need to scale it down, paste it after this. And then we have this X test and Y test. So just copy it and just paste it. So actually we don't need this training part, that is X train and Y train, because we have already trained the model, right? So I'll just remove this part. So let's cut it. So now I have deleted that training stuff because we are already using the pre-trained model. That's why I don't need that X train and Y train. So now we need to scale down this X test and Y test. And we also need to convert them into, okay, scaling we have already done. We need to convert them into NumPy arrays. So for that, I will just copy this line and I will paste it over here. Now the next thing is we have to make the predictions. So Y predicted, just copy it and just paste it. And the next thing is we have to just plot it. So, and we also need this scalar. So just copy this scalar and you can just paste it. So my scalar will be scalar.scale and I will just copy this line and you can just paste it over here. Now my scalar will not be the same scalar for every stock, right? So I'll just make it scalar at zero because we are getting this array, right? And my scalar is present at index 0. So my scalar will become scale factor will become 1 by scalar at 0. Okay, so now we have this predicted value and I have scaled it up by scale factor. We have also scaled up the Y test. Now we can just move on to this visualization. So I'll just copy it and I can just paste it over here and I can just put a comment final graph and I can just put a subheader st dot sub header, predicted, predictions versus original. And I can just name this as fig2. And instead of this plt.show, I will write st.pyplot fig2. Fig2. Yes. So let's save it. And I can just rerun my Streamlit app. So let's rerun it. So we are getting this closing price, and it is still running, right? You have to wait till it feeds the data into the model and we get the predictions. So we have to wait. So yes, now we are getting the predictions versus original graph like this, and we can just change the stock ticker, and you can check it out of AAPL, that is Apple. Hit enter and you will be able to see the Apple stock data, stock predictions versus original also. We might get some offset, but it's totally fine. Okay, we are not getting an offset also. It is perfectly fine. It's a very good trend analysis. So now we have completed this Streamlit web application that is regarding stock trend analysis, or we can say stock predictions. So I hope that you like this video. And if you want to give us any suggestion or feedback, you can do that in the comment section. Thank you for watching this video.